Hi, today is 5/14/20, and I'm really excited today to talk to you a little more about COVID-19. I want to share some of the developing science that's coming forward and a couple of important new therapies that are in the pipeline that are very encouraging and that people need to know about, and it needs to be disseminated far and wide. So I'm going to jump right to the therapeutic side to tweak your interest and attention. So there's a substance called Methylene-Blue. And, you know, many of us remember Methylene-Blue from microbiology classes. It's one of the substances we often use as a stain for looking at pathogenic organisms or cancer cells or things like that. But there's a condition called methemoglobinemia, where the body is unable to use oxygen adequately. So we believe that the COVID-19 virus seems to displace iron from the heme molecule, the molecule carrying oxygen in the body. And as a result, even though the oxygen is present, the body is unable to adequately utilize it. And so this medical condition called methemoglobinemia is treated with a substance called Methylene-Blue. And it's normally done either intravenously or as a nebulizer, very effective. So physicians that are practicing integrative holistic medicine around the country are starting to pay attention to this information and utilize Methylene-Blue either as a nebulizer or as an intravenous application for patients. And the initial evidence is very encouraging. Even patients with full-blown ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome, in a single treatment of nebulized Methylene-Blue are starting to develop normal lung oxygen perfusion function. So we're really encouraged by this. And as we speak, the Canadian government is about to start a clinical trial using Methylene-Blue with COVID patients. So stay tuned. We need to really pay attention and watch the outcomes of this and the work happening in clinics all around the country. So it seems that this virus creates a syndrome that's much like a high altitude pulmonary edema, where as we go up in altitude and oxygen is depleted in the atmosphere, we lose the ability to adequately perfuse oxygen through the body, and the lungs end up filling with fluid, and it's potentially life-threatening, often does result in death. So part of the story has kind of evolved in observing that when we do pulse oximetry on COVID-19 patients, and this is evaluating oxygen perfusion, we do this with a machine that we place on the finger, and it reads both the oxygen concentration and the pulse rate. And what we see very consistently with COVID-19 patients is that their levels are low. So a normal healthy person has a pulse ox level between 94 and 100. At 90 or lower, patients start to be symptomatic for signs of oxygen deprivation. COVID patients are walking into the hospital, talking, interacting normally with pulse ox levels at 75, sometimes even as low as 50. Under normal circumstances, these patients would not be walking and talking, but COVID-19 patients seem to be doing that. And when their pulse ox levels are at that level, they are at very high risk for quickly advancing into the ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome, which can then lead secondarily very quickly into what's called the cytokine storm. And the cytokine storm is a cascade of pro-inflammatory molecules caused by the virus that virtually shut down primary organ systems, in particular the lungs, the heart, and the kidneys, any of which can then lead to death. So if we can get to these patients early on when their pulse oximetry is low, before they advance, we think we have a very good chance of potentially stopping it cold. That said, I had shared that even in active ARDS, that using nebulized methylene-blue seems to be pulling patients back. So methylene-blue has five primary modes of action. One is that it blocks the pro-inflammatory mediators. So in particular, it blocks what's called IL-6, interleukin-6, IL-1B, interleukin-1 beta, HSCRP, high-sensitivity C-reactive protein, and NLRP3, which is an inflammasome. And NLRP3 is particularly interesting because it's also been correlated to what we think is part of the reason why children may not be as susceptible to the COVID-19 virus. And that is that young children from the age of 11 and younger have much higher levels of melatonin. So melatonin is a powerful hormone produced by the body, and it has a lot of functions. It's often associated with sleep induction, but it has a lot of other important functions in the body, and it seems that the NLRP3 inflammasome is melatonin dependent. So if melatonin is deficient, then this inflammasome can increase, and it can be a trigger for the cytokine reaction. So one of the things we're now recommending is that adult patients take between about 3 up to as much as 50 milligrams of melatonin before bed, obviously starting in the low end, and we think that may offer an important protective buffer against the virus and may be an important cofactor in treatment. So I said there's five things that the methylene-blue is doing. It's blocking these inflammatory mediators. If we use bioluminescence, which is light in the 550 to 700 nanometer range, which is a red band of light, it potentiates or activates the methylene-blue and is virucidal. It kills the virus on contact when activated with the light frequency. It's also increasing pH, so it's alkalinizing the body, and the COVID virus seems to be pH dependent. It's an acid dependent virus. So as we alkalinize the system, we create an inhospitable environment for the virus. And then it's oxidative to the virus itself. So this part of the killing component is it oxidizes the actual viral constituents. And then it, let's see, what else? So probably, first and foremost, actually, what the methylene-blue is doing is that it blocks the methemoglobin. Therefore, it puts iron back onto the heme molecule and reestablishes normal O2 profusion. So it effectively reverses the methemoglobinemia that the virus causes. And that's why respiratory function can return so rapidly. Not only can we use the Methylene-Blue in a nebulizer, but we can also use it intravenously. And both Methylene-Blue and intravenous vitamin C, which I've talked about earlier, and not only have the Chinese done studies showing how effective it is against COVID-19, but in the United States, we're also seeing some parallel studies starting to be taken up. And both of these substances, though, are dependent on an enzyme system called G6PD. And so before administering either high-dose vitamin C or Methylene-Blue, we need to test for that enzyme system. So these are things that you don't want to consider trying to do on your own. You need to go to a licensed physician who is knowledgeable in utilizing these therapies and get proper medical intervention. All of this information is merely educational. I'm not overtly advocating a direct therapy, and I'm not claiming some definitive answer here, but there is a body of early evidence that looks encouraging. And please share and spread this information. Please subscribe to my channel. We need to share this far and wide. People need to be hearing about intravenous vitamin C and intravenous and nebulized Methylene-Blue, and people need to be hearing about it now. All right. Thank you very much.